We welcome Betsy Salmonson to worship.
Good morning, everyone. I wish we could be together so I could give you a hug, shake your hand, bump your fist, elbow, or ankle. But as my son always says, it is what it is. My name is Betsy Salmonson. My family joined Christ Lutheran in 1969. After we moved from Los Angeles back to Minnesota, so our three children could grow up knowing their grandparents. Today is Cancer Awareness Sunday at CLC. It is also my father's birthday. And by the way, it's also the birthday of a wonderful girl, Emmy Fuller, who is 11 years old today. My dad died of colon cancer at the age of 87. In 1993. My brother died of bone cancer when he was 67. I have had two bouts with cancer, breast with a lumpectomy and radiation in 2013-14, and tongue cancer in 2016. Tongue cancer, no way. This cannot be happening to me. I've never even touched a cigarette in my life. It all began with my usual six-month check with my dentist. He said, "Something looks strange," and refers me to a specialist. The specialist says, "You don't have cancer. I wouldn't even do a biopsy." Then the teacher part of me came out, and I said, "You have to do a biopsy. I have to get my dentist off my back." Okay, he takes three biopsies, but doesn't keep track of the location because he is so sure there is no cancer. Results, two of the three are cancer. He refers me to another specialist. Time for surgery. I ended up in intensive care in an induced coma for 5 days. The medical personnel were not sure I would live, so all the kids were told to come quickly. Luckily, I remember nothing from that experience, but my kids remember every detail. When I had been home for a while, the kids gave me a notebook I had been writing in once I came out of the coma. My two favorite pages are these. One of them says, "When can I talk?" And the other one says, "I have a meeting on Thursday." Those who know me will know why they are my favorites. Just this past Friday, I was reading the Blaine Spring Lake Park newspaper and saw an article about Pastor Shane Burton. He grew up in Anoka County and was recently diagnosed with terminal cancer. And I quote from him, "I want to live. I want to live in all caps. Because when you write in all caps, it means you are shouting. I want to shout that life is about love, loving God, and loving each other." And now to Pastor Sarah for the announcements.
Thank you so much, Betsy, for starting worship in such a meaningful way. As she said, we are focusing on cancer awareness this week. We have special speakers like Betsy, as well as Jeff Christensen and his parents, Bob and Sue Christensen. And many of you sent names in order that we can read them, those who are currently cancer patients, those who are survivors, and those who have lost the battle to cancer. So we lift that all up, knowing that this is a disease that touches so many. A few announcements, though, for before we continue worship. One is Tuesday. I hope you have marked your calendars, circled. Maybe you don't even look at a calendar anymore, but Tuesday is in 2 days from now. Today's Sunday, and then Tuesday. And from 5 to 7 p.m., we are having a barbecue hot dog drive-through at Christ Lutheran Church. We ask you to enter on 89th Avenue, and you'll be directed through and then exit through the north part of the parking lot. There's also Holy Communion that night as well, in a very sanitary, self-contained way. So please show up for that. Your staff and council has been working really hard on that. Also want to say that there is also fellowship time again following worship today. So if you would like to stay on and be put into a breakout group with a few other folks after the postlude, we'll do that. Those are the most important announcements for today. But our worship continues in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. For our litany today, when you hear me say, "We believe," please respond with, "This is most certainly true." As we live with things that we cannot control, God is in control. The power of heaven and the power of faith and hope is alive and cannot be contained. We believe this is most certainly true. When doubt and fear sees roadblocks, faith sees a way through. When doubt and fear see only darkness, faith sees the light of a new day. When doubt and fear keep us from taking the next step, faith gives us wings as eagles. We believe this is most certainly true. In the face of illness and loss, doubt will ask the question, "Who among us believes?" And we boldly say, "This is most certainly true." We gather, trusting in God and trusting in God's Son, who healed the sick, who made the lame to see, the blind to see, and the lame to walk. We believe in a love so strong that nothing can separate us from the powers of heaven. We believe this is most certainly true. We head over to the sanctuary to sing our opening song, "Shout to the Lord."
Savior, Lord, there is none like you all of my days. shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Love every breath, all that I am. Never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King.
To Andrew for the children's sermon.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to invite all the kiddos and even the kids at heart to come as close as they can to their screens, just like you're coming on up to the front of the sanctuary for our children's message. Today, our children's message is going to be really special. It honestly might be the best one I've ever done. In fact, I brought this huge box of props to help me out. There's like 20 props in here, guys. I'm going to show them all to you before I start the sermon. There's so many, and they're so cool. First, we're going to start out with the Spark Children's Bible. Basic. We need that every time, of course, to tell our stories. And then, of course, we also have, the Complete Works of William Shakespeare. That's going to be really important. We might read through Romeo and Juliet or something like that. Obviously, this is going to be a great children's message. We got some bug spray here. We might need to spray that during the children's message. That's going to be really important to have. And let's see. Hold on. I'm getting a phone call. One sec. Hello, this is Andrew. Yeah. Oh, hi, Jesus. How are you today? Can you actually call me back? I'm in the middle of a church service. I'm doing a children's message. Can't really talk right now. What, you want me to tell them that grace is enough? No, Jesus, I've got this huge children's message planned. I can't do that. Bye. All right, I've got a few more props here to show you. Let's see, I've got my college diploma here. That's going to be super important. Yep. Let's see. Jesus keeps calling me. I can't deal with this. I've also got this donkey head with some grass growing out of it. That's going to be a huge part of this amazing children's message. Jesus, stop calling. Let's see. I've also got a duck. That's going to be really important. That's going to help us tell a story. He keeps calling. Okay. I think I got to take this. Hold on. One sec. Jesus, will you stop calling me? I'm in the middle of my children's message, and it's really important that I show these kids what all these crazy props are for. You want me to tell them that grace is enough? Yeah, Jesus, that's not like super special or crazy. It is super special. Okay, I guess so. All right, guys, Jesus has commanded it. I guess our children's message today is just me telling you that grace is enough. And grace is this really cool thing that tells us even when we do bad things, like bring like all these crazy objects to a children's message that you have no intention to use, that God forgives you and God loves you always. So we're going to head over to Mark for a reading in a second here, but let's pray together first. Would you repeat after me? Dear God, thank you for your grace, and thank you for calling us by name. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to head over to Mark.
Great. Thank you, Andrew. Somebody give me a thumbs up if you can hear me. All right. Super. Well, the reading today comes from the 43rd chapter of the book of Isaiah, beginning with the first verse. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you. Because you are my precious in my sight and honored, and I love you, I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Sarah, for the reading.
Second reading this morning comes from Romans, the 5th chapter, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Next, we have three additional speakers, all coming from one family. We have Jeff Christensen, Bob and Sue Christensen. And again, they will tell the story that that can only be told, as like Betsy did, from the heart of their own impact by cancer and its ways that they have used their faith to draw upon in the time of fighting an illness. And we heard, I think, from both that Isaiah and that Romans reading so beautifully, how our faith can be a foundation even in overwhelming times, and how hope does not disappoint us. So first to Jeff, and then to Bob and Sue.
Thank you, Pastor Sarah, and good morning. My name is Jeff Christensen. Thank you for the opportunity to share my cancer journey with you today. Let me first start by saying thank you to the Christ Lutheran faith community for the countless prayers and positive thoughts throughout my journey. I grew up in this church, and I have very fond memories of singing, participating in the youth musical, traveling to Harlan, Kentucky on a mission trip, and attending the National Youth Gathering in Atlanta in 1996. I even learned guitar from Chris O'Brien, something I still enjoy today. Thank you, Chris. My parents, Bob and Sue, and my brother, Matt, and his family continue to be active members of Christ Lutheran. Today, I'm talking to you from St. Paul, Maggie and Henry. My cancer journey began right before Christmas 2018. I still remember the day I got the call, leukemia. The news was shocking. I felt paralyzed. I distinctly remember just laying on the floor, unsure of how to process the news. I was admitted to the hospital for a lengthy stay for induction chemotherapy, designed to reduce the blast, immature white blood cells in my bone marrow. I remember at the time being overwhelmed by the enormity of what lay before me. A long hospital stay, lots of chemo, and an unknown outcome. To cope with the enormity, I took the advice from a Mayo doctor who I met with early on. He first asked if I had siblings. This was important because the best outcome for me would hinge upon having a perfect match for a stem cell transplant. He stressed the importance also to compartmentalize. Take things one day at a time and not get ahead of myself. This was incredibly good advice. After nearly a month in the hospital, we learned that the initial treatment was largely unsuccessful. We should start thinking about clinical trials and other options. This was incredibly difficult to hear. My uncle Russ, who's a minister in Houston, flew up to Minneapolis to pray over me. I also received Reiki therapy as well as communion to help with my spiritual healing. And of course, Pastor Kent visited on numerous occasions to help keep my spirits up. Still, the news that the initial treatment was unsuccessful left me feeling pretty hopeless. I started to doubt that I'd be able to get through this illness and be healthy again. I wrote letters to my kids and my wife. I even filled out a healthcare directive. It was my lowest point. However, as I reflect on this, I know that all these things were instrumental in helping my soul heal the cancer. After the bad news, we were going to seek care elsewhere. So I was discharged only to end up back in the hospital 12 hours later because I had spiked a fever. But I was readmitted. We decided after lots of prayers that the doctor's plan B course of chemotherapy was the best course of action. And miraculously, it worked wonders, reducing my blast to the point, that a few months later, I became a candidate for a stem cell transplant, which was the goal. Hard for me to describe how much my outlook changed for the better during these times. I remember having breakfast with my mom and my dad after I learned that I'd be able to get a transplant. And I felt such absolute joy in that simple moment of sharing a meal and thinking that things might be okay. A stem cell transplant requires a donor, though. At the beginning of my journey, all my brothers were tested to see if they were a match. According to the doctors, there was a 25% chance that one would be a match. I still remember how uplifting it was to receive the news that they were all, in fact, matches. I also want to pause and say that my brothers are the best. They fought over who would get to be the donor, joking about... Sorry, guys. What characteristics of theirs I would pick up as a result of the transplant? As you can hopefully see, I didn't end up with red hair. The transplant was done on April 30th, my rebirth day. The hospital chaplain conducted a short service to commemorate the moment, and I was surrounded by my brothers, my parents, my wife, Bridget, and her parents. I'm so deeply grateful for the countless people that helped me through this journey. My mom and my dad were there almost every day, bringing me food, even Dairy Queen, and checking in with me on my latest lab results. My wife, Bridget, was also there almost every day, advocating for my care, keeping our three kids happy and healthy, and helping them to understand what Dad was going through. My brothers visited often. Bridget's parents watched our kids and handled fixes around the house. Our friends and neighbors provided meals, walked our dog, and shoveled our sidewalk. And so many people prayed. I especially want to thank the members of Christ Lutheran for their prayers. It's been humbling to hear of how many people around the country have added me to their prayers at the request of a family member or friend. Thank you so much. I have no doubt that the power of all that prayer was instrumental in my recovery. I'd say that my journey is a story of love and hope. There's no way I would have made it through without all the love and hope of my family, friends, and neighbors. It's also a story about the power of prayer. It has taught me to be thankful for every moment, cherish the time with my family, and turn to prayer to help me with things outside my control. It has also taught me how to cope with things that seem so large in the moment, but are in fact just temporary, and with patience, perseverance will eventually improve. All throughout my life, my mom and dad have told me that this too shall pass. And that is so true. It has also been an invaluable lesson given what our whole world is going through right now. Bridget and I talk often about how this journey prepared us for her current turbulent times. We feel so much stronger having been through this journey and learning what we can withstand. I want to end with a quote my dad has shared with our family. We are pilgrims on this journey. We're together on this road. We're here to help each other walk the mile and bear the load. Thank you again for helping me bear the load.
We are Jeff's parents, Bob and Sue Christensen. We have been members of CLC since 1978, and we have four sons, Chris, Matt, Jeff, and John. Who would think that a casual mention of indigestion at the end of November 2018 would lead to a diagnosis of leukemia? Jeff was such a healthy young man. He had just turned 40. He was a bike rider. It was nothing for him and his friends to ride 50 miles on a Saturday morning. He rode his bike to work from his home in St. Paul to downtown Minneapolis, office, and year-round. Hearing the diagnosis, we were stunned. What do we do now? How can we make this better? Since this is what we as parents try to do, no Band-Aid will work for this. We thought about Jeff's family. What would this disease mean for them? How would their kids react? Cece was 10, Maggie was 9, and Henry 5 when Jeff received his diagnosis. Would Jeff and Bridget be able to maintain their employment? Would they need to sell their beautiful home? These were all questions on our mind those first few days. Cece came up with the theme, hashtag keep moving forward. It became a rallying cry for our family. We even had shirts made. Maggie, a green-eyed lefty, a trait she shares with her dad, offered to support Jeff with her hugs and artwork. Henry, at 5, processed things a bit differently. A quick funny story we have to share. When Jeff returned home from his first long hospital stay, Cece and Maggie were smothering him with love and hugs, and Henry casually asked, "Oh, Dad. Hey, Dad, how's the doctor?" We were at Jeff and Bridget's house just prior to Christmas when he said goodbye to his family for that first 45-day hospital stay. We all cried. Actually, we cried a lot in those days. Nancy Halepsa called to say she had soup for us. We let her message roll to voicemail because neither of us could talk without crying. Family would call to inquire about Jeff, and we would have to take turns talking through our tears. We tried to go to church to attend a funeral and just sat at a table close to the Welcome Center. I'm sure we looked pretty pathetic. Pastor Sarah took one look at us and said, "Can I pray with you?" That was exactly what we needed. As the word of Jeff's diagnosis spread, we experienced the power of prayer. Friends would call and say, "What can we pray about today?" There were prayer groups all over the state and our nation praying for Jeff. We all felt the power in those prayers. We stayed as close to Jeff as he and his doctors would allow during his treatments. We often brought him food, since he wasn't a fan of hospital food. Sometimes he was well enough to eat, and sometimes he wasn't. We would text him every morning to check in to see how he was doing, and based on how he felt, we would decide when we would visit. We needed to see him and let him know he was loved. One day we were bringing him a smoothie from the hospital coffee shop and struck up a conversation with a person in the elevator. She mentioned that her son used to love smoothies too, but his mouth was so full of sores from chemo and radiation, he couldn't tolerate them any longer. We asked her how long her son had been battling this disease. She said, 2 years. His name is Travis, and he's still on our prayer list. We were reminded many times that leukemia is like riding a roller coaster, lots of ups and downs. In early 2019, as Jeff was getting closer to a stem cell transplant, he ended up back in the hospital with a strep infection. When he finally met the criteria for transplant, just a week later, we were elated. We danced around the house, all the while praising God. There were some hard days ahead, but we knew Jeff would have a life beyond leukemia. We experienced so many miracles during these days. Jeff talked about his brothers all being matches for a stem cell transplant, the first miracle. We believe that fever that brought him to the University of Minnesota was also a miracle. The third we were aware of was the drug that hadn't been on the market for more than a year was key to getting Jeff closer to transplant. We also know there were many miracles beyond those we noticed. We are so thankful for Bridget. She is a rock. Her faith is strong, and she took charge of her family and of Jeff's care and communicated with the rest of us how best to help him. We are so thankful for the family that all stepped up to help in whatever way they could. Our sons all contributed to Jeff's care in their own ways, sometimes through their humor, and for our son John, who stayed healthy and was eager to donate his cells. We are so grateful for the medical staff at the Mayo Clinic and the University of Minnesota, who kept us informed and were encouraging throughout. We are so grateful for Jeff and Bridget's employers, who were flexible and kept them employed the whole time. We are so grateful for all the people we met at the University of Minnesota, including the valet staff who prayed for Jeff. And we're so grateful for CLC. You, our church family, have been on this journey with Jeff and with us. We are grateful for your constant support. You've given us hugs when we needed them. You've cheered with us when there were good news. You prayed. You sent cards. You gave us care packages to take to the hospital. We are so blessed to be a part of this community. Thank you. We also felt God's presence. We know cancer affects so many people, and we certainly don't wish this or any disease on anyone, but for us, it brought us closer as a family and closer to God. Thank you.
Called you each by name.
And now to both of our pastors for prayers.
You might notice I'm broadcasting today from my office. I hope you can hear me just fine, I trust. As Mark said, wave if you can hear me. Great. Fantastic. Jeff, it is an honor to be wearing my Just Moving Forward shirt that your daughter had her hand in designing. And I think your entire family had a good marketing strategy out there for getting these sold in your honor. So also, my fondest of visiting with you is our long conversations as dads with Lego obsession. So I think there's a 12-step program for us that we probably should be attending around Lego. But we gather together as the body of Christ, hearing the power of prayer in the lives of all in need of healing, especially on this Sunday as we recognize cancer awareness. Let us prepare for prayer in a way in which today's service, we will read off the names that you have given to us, and you will hear them aloud throughout the prayers. Please pray. Shepherd and God, we pray for all those who are fighting cancer. Give them the hope and courage they need each day. Comfort them in their pain and bless them with healing. We lift up the following current cancer patients: Michael, Sue, Charlie, Catherine, Ken, Jason, Tom, Amy, Heather, Jeff, Helen, Bruce, Kim, Linda, Melanie, Lou, Beverly, Pearl, Julie, Dave, Hector, Sue, Marty, Cody, Harry, Melanie, Larry, Kathy, and Mary.
Lord of all hopefulness and love, there is healing and newness of life in you. Today we lift up names of people from our own faith community and others who are survivors of cancer: Epi, Christine, Raymond, Peter, Kitty, Gretchen, Rose, Galen, Judy, Pat, Kate, Jody, Scott, Julie, Gail, Paulette, Robin, Lois, Linda, Diane, Deanne, Sue, Diane, Marilyn, Paul, Marie, Irv, Roxanne, Todd, Terry, Jeff, Paul, Yvonne, Mike, Karen, Richard, Phyllis. We also lift up Dana, Judy, Carol, Sherry, Mary Jo, Judith, Sharon, Mary, Eileen, Kim, Agnes, Kevin, Kathy, Gina, Jamie, Tom, Sandy, Kim, Merle, Carol, Carolyn, Betty, John, Mary, Renee, Jason, and Nancy.
Comforting God, we remember those who are no longer with us, knowing their suffering is over and eternal life with you has begun. This morning, we remember Carol, Ben, Marie, Christine, Marie, Herbert, Arda, Donna, Deborah, Cindy, Frank, Sharon, Dave, Denny, Lynn, Karen, Herman, Judy, Ashley, Donna, Judy, Debbie, Phyllis, Josh, Cheryl, Diana, Irene, John, Scott, Jamie, Aaron, Joyce, Carolyn, Donna, Carol, Tony, Linnea, Gloria, Joan, Keith, Shirley, Don, Red, Evelyn, Mary, Raleigh, Don, Gloria, Phyllis, Rudolph, Donald, Charlotte, Dave, Molly, Priscilla, Carla, Irene, Roger, Ruth, Jean, Palmer, Linda, and Irvin.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those desires too deep for words, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Thank you, everyone, for your prayers. And we know that there are many names we did not read that are in your hearts and in our community and in the world in need of healing. We're reminded that our giving, our generosity continues to be a force of community. And that force of community is what enables the prayer teams and the visits and the ministries of Christ Lutheran Church. So just know that your continued generosity, your continued support financially of Christ Lutheran Church is also an instrument by which we are able to help the world and change the world with the love of Christ and the hope of the resurrection. We have a special video that we would like to show. It's kind of a prayer, a song, and video all in one. It is a visual prayer for all that are currently impacted by disease. It highlights those workers in the COVID-19 realm. So at this time, as we conclude our prayers and in our offerings, we have this video to share.
Praise be the nurses and doctors, every medical staff bent over flesh to offer care, for lives saved and lives lost, for showing up either way. Praise for the farmers tilling soil, planting seeds so food can grow, an act of hope if ever there was. Praise be the janitors and garbage collectors, the grocery store clerks and the truck drivers barreling through long, quiet nights. Give thanks for bus drivers, delivery persons, postal workers, and all those keeping an eye on water, gas, and electricity. Blessings on our leaders making hard choices for the common good, offering words of assurance. Celebrate the scientists working a way to understand the thing that plagues us, to find an antidote, and all the medicine makers. Praise be the journalists keeping us informed. Praise be the teachers, finding new ways to educate children from afar, and blessings on parents holding it together for them. Blessed are the elderly and those with weakened immune systems, all those who worry for their health. Praise for those who stay at home to protect them. Blessed are the domestic violence victims on lockdown with abusers, the homeless and refugees. Praise for the artists and poets, the singers and storytellers, all those who nourish with words and sound and color. Blessed are the ministers and therapists of every kind, bringing words of comfort. Blessed are the ones whose jobs are lost, who have no savings, who feel fear of the unknown gnawing. Blessed are those in grief, especially who mourn alone. Blessed are those who have passed into the great night. Praise for police and firefighters, paramedics, and all who work to keep us safe. Praise for all the workers and caregivers of every kind. Praise for the sound of notifications, messages from friends reaching across the distance. Give thanks for laughter and kindness. Praise be our four-footed companions with no forethought or anxiety, responding only in love. praise for the seas and rivers, forests and stones who teach us to endure. Give thanks for your ancestors, for the wars and plagues they endured and survived. Their resilience is in your bones and your blood. Blessed is the water that flows over our hands and the soap that helps keep them clean each time a baptism. Praise every moment of stillness and silence so new voices can be heard. Praise the chance and slowness. Praise be the birds who continue to sing the sky awake each day. Praise for the primrose poking yellow petals from dark earth. Blessed is the air clearing overhead so one day we can breathe deeply again. And when this has passed, may we say that love spread more quickly than any virus ever could. May we say this was not just an ending, but also a place to begin.
And whether we hear the phone ring, miss the phone call, or pick it up and know it is Jesus, might we know that God's grace is enough. Gathered by the Holy Spirit, let us pray the prayer taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, now we have some awesome music, so I'm going to send it over from the office back to the sanctuary.
to Pastor Kent for the blessing.
Thank you so much. Our musicians are amazing. Linda LaFond. It is Derek Hartman flying fingers at the white ivories there. I don't know if at the postlude Chance can adjust the camera onto those fingers, but boy, oh boy, he can make that piano dance for sure. So we are blessed with our musicians. We are blessed with our church staff. I know our church staff is gearing up to grill some hot dogs. I hope you guys like hot dogs. Does anyone like hot dogs? Wave. All right. We expect to see everyone driving through the parking lot. Don't get out of your cars, but come on, drive through. We'll give you some hot dogs. It should be fun. Should be just amazing. I cannot thank Jeff enough. I love that your daughters are dancing in their background. You got to get your big head out of the way because they almost took it off there. There you go. That's right. So just amazing. And Andrew rocked it with a children's message. And Pastor Sarah always puts our worships together with Chris O'Brien. I can't thank everyone enough. What a day to celebrate cancer awareness. And just staggering all the ways that all of our lives have been touched by cancer and the way that God's grace is enough in all that we face in our lives. And don't worry, Drew Swenson said by next Sunday he'll have a haircut. No? Okay, well, we can hope. All right, let's have a sending and blessing. Touched by your grace, O God, we take your grace to the world. Healed by your love, Jesus, we take your love to the world. Renewed by your Spirit, we go in the Spirit's power to be agents of healing and living as children of the light. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let your people say amen. All right. Off to Pastor Sarah for some quick announcements, I think, on how we do this whole fellowship time. I know it's not in the script, but I don't really know how it works. So there you go. Thank you. Save me.
Sure. Remember, there's going to be a postlude, and just stay on. So if you want to enjoy the postlude, great. After the postlude, you'll just put it into those groups. So let's go hear that wonderful music by Derek and the rest of the musicians.